What is to be like an Intel medicine resident? Is it good, bad, ugly, or a combination of all? Let's check it out. One of the best things that I felt Intel medicine brings you on table is the flexibility and the independence it provides you. Independence in the sense you're less likely to be dependent to other healthcare professional like your technicians, anesthesiologists, or the apparatus itself, at least compared to your surgical counterparts. People who are practicing internal medicine will know how complex it can get at times. Complexities in the sense it can be quite frustrating to make out what's really happening in the patient at times, but these complexities are the ones that gives life challenge, plus at the same time that makes the subject most fascinating according to me. Plus, an internist life is all about unraveling these complexities and mysteries, and as he starts unraveling the complexities and mysteries, he's going to really understand how truly elegant and beautiful the subject is. Plus, an internist life is all about applying these unraveled mysteries and complexities on the patients and making the journey even more purposeful. Being a doctor itself means you're going to impact a lot of lives in the community, and that's why we become a doctor. And internist in this particular perspective is a little above other specialties, according to me at least, because an internist is going to focus on the preventive care as much as he does on the treatment part. This is one of the USPs of internal medicine. Compared to all other specialties, you're going to focus more on the preventive aspect of diseases as well. And by this, even if you impact a single life in the community, that can impact an entire family. And that impact on the family that you create, who knows, might impact an entire community as well. And as an icing on the top, all of what you're going to practice is absolutely evidence-based. You have plenty of super specialties to choose from. You have cardiology, neurology, rheumatology and clinical immunology, pulmonary medicine, gastroenterology, endocrinology, hematology, medical oncology, critical care. You can choose anything out of this, whichever you are interested in. And once you have gone into a particular super specialty, you can try and focus on a particular disease or a particular segment in that particular specialty and make yourself the best in that particular field. And you have a variety of options for research. And once you start doing research, you will truly understand what's going on in your community, and you'll be able to impact more lives in the community. One of the most important things a resident should do right from the first year residency is the fact that he has to remove that idea of empirical diagnosis and treatment. The less empirical you are, the better clinician you're going to be. Of course, you are going to make an empirical diagnosis and treatment, especially in times of emergency when you want to save a life of a patient. But even that empirical diagnosis and treatment should be evidence-based and not at the likes of any particular individual. One of the powers or skills, I can say, that an internist is going to develop during the residency or during the practice is the observational skills. The more observant an internist is, the faster it is going to understand the disease process and the faster it is going to make a diagnosis and start the treatment, which is going to definitely impact the patient in a very big way. And these observational skills are the ones which are going to translate into kind of a roadmap. I always say that we internists are kind of Tony Starks, who always have this kind of mind maps, and we're going to predict the future and what's going to happen because of the diagnosis and the treatment. And of course, we have to know about the complications of the disease and the implications of the treatment itself. And one of the common questions that is asked by every single first year resident at the time of joining the residency is what books to read. And I would say that books are not the only thing in your residency, and books are important, but not the only thing. And of course, books without patients or patients without books, both doesn't make any sense at all. If you want to categorize, I would say like 10 to 15% books and 10 to 15% articles and journals, and 25% of the time has to be invested in the new research, and 50%, of course, the patient practice. This is the kind of balance I expect from most of my residents, and this for most of the people will work as well. When I was a postgraduate, myself and one of my professors were having a casual discussion after a weekday's rounds. And during the time, we have been discussing on the aspects and impacts of internal medicine in the patient's life. And that time, I was telling that diagnosis is one of the most important things that an internist should try and make. And And for that, my professor replied that diagnosis is not one of the important things, and diagnosis is the only thing an internist should strive for. So once you make a diagnosis, everything else becomes easy in internal medicine. And of course, treatment, once you know the diagnosis, anyone can do that. But the proper diagnosis, a good internist will be the only one who will be able to do that. Remember, knowing what is normal is as important as knowing what is not normal. Overdiagnosis and overkilling with therapies and drugs are equally as dangerous as missing a particular diagnosis in a case. And definitely, if you're not knowing what is normal, it's going to spoil your reputation in the future. Plus, it's going to negatively impact on the patient's life in the form of the unreasonable diagnosis you make or unreasonable therapies that you're going to give, which is going to have a lot of harmful effects on the patient. Now, one of the common mistakes that any internal medicine resident tends to do at the beginning of his or her residency is to fix into a particular specialty. And fixing into a particular specialty should be avoided, according to me, at least throughout the course of internal medicine residency, because the beauty of internal medicine itself is to see the patient as a whole and not getting biased towards one particular system. And please understand, unless and until you are a good internist, you can't make a good super specialist. Considering the surveys around the world, internal medicine is one of the fields where the satisfaction scores have been very, very poor. And this could be partly attributed to the mindset at the time of doing the residency. Plus, at the same time, contrary to the popular belief that your interventional fields are going to give you more kick, it's the other way around. These surveys have found out that the non-interventional fields, or the so-called lesser interventional fields like rheumatology or probably endocrinology, actually have a higher satisfaction scores, maybe because of a very peaceful family life and you don't get the midnight calls as much as you get in the interventional fields. Selecting a super specialty can be really, really tricky, and it opens the Pandora's box again. And many of the students will be facing the same confusion as they are faced after MBBS, whether to choose MD or MS. Likewise, you're going to face a lot of confusion as to what super specialty you need to choose. And I would say that being an internist, don't try and fix into a particular specialty. And you can have interest in a particular specialty, that's different, but don't try and fix and get biased into a particular specialty during the time of residency. Internal medicine specialty is to see the patient as a whole and try and learn every single aspect of internal medicine from all the specialties. And maybe the best time to choose a specialty will be the mid-final year, or maybe after giving the board exams, where you'll be in the best of your mindset to select a specialty from. And of course, choose a super specialty that not only yields money, plus at the same time gives you the best satisfaction index. And you need to choose accordingly. What is your love? And you need to select that. Don't just go by the blatant aspect of money. And ultimately, happiness is everything. Whenever I talk about earnings or money, it becomes a little tricky and controversial. And how much earnings a person needs to keep himself happy is completely self-dependent, totally personal. So I leave it to you. And Gandhiji once rightly said, the world has everything for everyone's need, but not for anyone's greed. And of course, earning has become a little difficult considering the last 15 to 20 years, maybe partly because of the competition that is keeping on increasing and the number of internists and the specialists that are accumulating in a particular area. Plus, I would say that as an internist or probably as a super specialist, you need to just wait on, and of course, patience is a virtue. Leave alone choosing a particular specialty, getting into that particular specialty is becoming very difficult and a tough ask because of the level of difficulty the questions are being asked in the entrance exams, and of course the competition that is getting stiffer and stiffer day by day. And we dream team at PrepLadderSS are here to help you, push you, motivate you to your finest best so that you can crack one of the most toughest exams in the country right now.